So let me just give you a little bit of, you know, what we're talking about. Between 1919 and about 1940, we're talking about the countries of Greece. We're talking about Yugoslavia, which was formerly called the Kingdom of the Serbs, Croats, and Slovenes, Kraljevstvo Srbe, Hrvati I Sloveni, in Serbo-Croatian. Yes, I can speak Serbo-Croatian. We're also talking about Bulgaria, Romania, Albania, and Turkey. So this is what the Balkan area, Balkan region, which we're going to be sort of referring to. Most of this area is largely a mountainous region, largely agricultural. About 75% of the population between the 1920s and 30s are involved in agriculture. To give you a little bit of a comparison, less than 3% of the U.S. population is right now involved in agriculture. So agriculture was hugely, these were rural, underdeveloped regions of Europe at the beginning of the Second World War. This was the, in some ways, not Ukraine, but the other breadbasket of Europe. One of the least industrialized regions of Europe, just to make that point sort of clear. Now, what's going on? What kind of politics are we seeing in this region between 1919 and 1940? Well, guess what? By the beginning of the war, not one of the countries that we are talking about, not Romania, Yugoslavia, Bulgaria, Albania, Greece, are democracies. Their brief flirtations with parliamentary democracy all fail by a few years before the war, and they all become in some way either royalist dictatorships, like in 1929, King Aleksandar Karadjordjevic of Yugoslavia declares a royal dictatorship, and there is a parliamentary dictatorship, as George mentioned, by Metaksa in the 1930s. So what is going on politically in the Balkans is that the old agricultural elites and the royal families are moving to the right in politics. Well, let's see. Yes, for you, it's this way. For me, it's this way. But they're moving to the right. They're becoming very conservative. And in a number of countries, especially Romania, Hungary, and partly in Yugoslavia, very, very strong nationalistic and semi-fascist organizations, the Iron Guard in Romania, and the, which is also called the Order of St. Michael, they become very, very powerful. So very powerful right-wing groups are pushing these countries towards fascism, which eventually helps in their joining of the Axis. So what are we talking about here? Because of the Great Depression, because of peasant radicalism, this is what brings in these royal dictatorships. Also, because of, George mentioned the Balkan Wars, all of these countries were new. Yugoslavia was newly minted in 1919 out of parts of the old Ottoman Empire, the independent Serbia from the 1830s, and then all of the remnants of the Habsburg Empire. Greece expanded, Bulgaria expanded, and Romania expanded, incorporating new ethnic rivalries. So all through the teens and 20s, these ethnic rivalries continue. Powerful groups, as an example here in Serbia, in Yugoslavia, the Kingdom of the Serbs, Croats, and Slovenes, we would basically say, I'm half Serbian, so I can say this, it was a basically Serb-dominated royal family, and Serbian interests were elevated over the interests of Croats and over the interests, of course, of Macedonians, Bosnian Muslims, and other many, many other ethnic groups, Roma, Gypsies, and Jews. So it was almost a dictatorship of Serbs partnered with Croats, and the main conflict in Yugoslavia, pre-war Yugoslavia, was between the Croats and the Serbs. And the Serbs were the most powerful group. Another idea, to give you an idea of what kind of politics was going on here, Bulgaria, because of the two Balkan Wars and because of World War I, lost all of its territorial aspirations. Bulgaria, I'll show you a map later, wanted its irredentism, was looking to colonize and take Macedonia. The Bulgarian nationalism taught that the Macedonians, the Makedonci, were Bulgarians. Nisme Bulgari, they would say. These are Bulgarians. So Bulgarian nationalism was really frustrated by the time World War I ends, and it remains frustrated throughout the next 20 years. So Bulgaria is really interested in revising those borders. One reason, though not the only reason, that Bulgaria eventually joins the Axis. So what map are we? This is the more familiar map. These borders were only new in 1919. This laser pointer doesn't work on this screen, but this is Macedonia here. These areas, that's what Bulgaria wanted. Bulgaria, will, you'll see in later maps, will be given those after the invasion and occupation. And Yugoslavia, you'll see in just a few slides, will be totally carved up to an unrecognizable position. But this is more or less what the Balkans looks like at the beginning of World War II. And eventually, all but Greece do sign on with the Axis. And I'll tell you in a minute how Yugoslavia, in a surprise move, pulls out of the Axis, and then sort of all hell breaks loose at that point. So we have actually, at this point, with war, invasion, and partition, we have Yugoslavia had signed on with the Axis. So every country was now an Axis country, save Greece. But there was a coup d'etat. The former government, what was called the Svetković-Maček government, who signed the tripartite pact, was overthrown by a bunch of gung-ho Serbian generals, and the Serbian generals, led by Simović, overthrows the old government, topples the regent, Prince Regent Pavle, and puts Prince Peter, who is 17 or 18 at the time, and says, he's ready to rule. So Peter is on the throne. They break the pact, and they say, let's go to war. But guess what happens? In order to get the Croats to agree, they reinstate the pact. They actually said, okay, we'll rejoin the Axis. But guess what happened? Too late. The furious Führer says, basically decides, enough with the Balkan, so-called Balkan powder keg. April 6th, he orders the Wehrmacht into Yugoslavia and into Greece. From Yugoslavia, Yugoslavia is invaded from four different countries. Greece is basically invaded from two. So the breakup of Yugoslavia comes extreme with great rapidity, enormous rapidity. Yugoslavia falls within about, here's the invasion, simultaneous invasion of Greece and Yugoslavia on April 6th. Yugoslavia falls with enormous rapidity. 12 days, Yugoslavia is totally divided. Invasion from four different directions. Belgrade, the city of Belgrade, is bombed by Stuka bombers. 17,000 die in that bombardment. Later, even more die when the Allies again bomb, and then the Germans again bomb. There was quite a number of bombings of Belgrade. Greece holds out a few days longer, but not much. Within 4 to 6 weeks, the entire Balkans is taken by German troops. I wanted to show this briefly since George got his YouTube clip to work. I'm hoping ours will.
The entry of Greece into the war was assured by Mussolini on May the 5th, 1940, when Italian troops garrisoned in Albania launched an invasion through the mountains of northwestern Greece. Though small and inadequately equipped, the Greek army inflicted a series of crushing defeats on the Italians, driving them back through the mountains and over the border into Albania.
I might fast forward since we have covered this fairly well.
Stunning counteroffensives, the Greeks had crossed the Albanian frontier and driven the Italians from the southernmost quarter of the country. The union in the spring of 1941. To secure the flank,
that's always a difficulty with this. Basically, it's a film that at least briefly also includes the Yugoslav invasion, but we might be suffering with this one for a minute, so we might come back to that. Let's just return here. So if we look here, this is the railway station in Belgrade after the bombing. Shtuka dive bombers hit the railway station, and you can see this large spot right at the front where several bombs must have totally taken out the front of the railway station, and this was in April of 1941. And then this is the Germans raising the swastika above the Acropolis. Not a few weeks later in Athens. Interesting story here, only about 4 weeks after this flag is raised, Greek resistors, spontaneous resistance starts to be created in Greece, and they climb this flagpole and rip it down. I don't remember whether they were found or not, but they are, the names of the two young boys that did this are known. I don't know what happened to them, whether there was a reprisal against them.